The rich diversity of the world's cultures reflects a corresponding diversity in the wilds that gave them birth.
I think the core question of the modern practice of conservation is testing Leopold's idea. Is it possible for there to be this inevitable fusion between people to create a new kind of ethic? You know, and I've staked my life and my career on the fact that it is possible. The work of conservation today is to build bridges. Build bridges between people and the land, but also between people and one another. That's Leopold's legacy for us.
Leopold was born and lived and died in U.S., but it doesn't mean that he belonged just to U.S. And his idea universal, and it's very important. It's like Baikal Lake. Yes, it's inside Russia, but Baikal Lake the only one for the entire world, and means that it belonged to much more people than just the people from surrounding area.
The urgency of environmental crisis in China really makes people think about the environment, people's relationship with nature more seriously. When we look at traditional Chinese culture, we could see some kind of remote resonance of a land ethic in traditional Chinese culture. And this land ethic, as expressed by Aldo Leopold, was not really unfamiliar for Chinese people. Because his that kind of humble and holistic attitude toward nature was a part of Chinese vision of nature.
I think it's very natural for anybody to posit Leopold's land ethic to many continents across the globe, where people continue to strive to find this balance between the way that they're living, the way that the populations are growing, and the demands of the city dwellers are increasing in proportions which is way more than what the earth can sustain. So I think it makes current sense to go back and revisit Leopold and also try and understand it with local contexts where people have been doing this for a very, very long time, for time immemorial.
I interviewed Khmer refugees from the Pol Pot genocide who had been subject to torture, starvation, and forced labor in rice fields. And the first thing they wanted to do in America was grow a garden. And one of my translator, who was the nephew of one of the growers, said to me, they're not crazy. This is where they want to be because this is the thing that's kind to them. It doesn't speak to them in a foreign language. It speaks to them in their own language. So I think the idea of the land ethic, which is that it's a universal language, that is, if you know how to tend the soil, the earth responds. The human beings around you may not know how to pronounce your name. They may not understand your language. They may be alienated from you because they consider you a stranger and an outsider. But if you kneel down and plant the earth skillfully and pay attention to that piece of land, it will speak to you. It will respond. And I think that's the essence of the land ethic.
In Kenya, from where I come from, the Maasai communities traditionally own land communally. The now coming in of subdivision and parceling up of land into small parcels of land and individualizing the ownership has brought people to start doing things in a bit selfish way. You know, a culture of individualization has cropped in, and that is a dangerous way to go for the pastoralists, because the moment you start restricting that I have my farm and I want to graze in my farm, you cannot survive. You cannot be able to take your animals throughout the year.
Elder Leopold saw the decimation of land. And so he tried to go back to an earlier time in one sense, but using scientific metaphors that allowed him to reconstruct the relationship between people and the larger landscape. We're going through exactly the same in Africa today. Here you have Maasai who've lived in Africa for 3,000 years with cattle. They've maintained grasslands which are believed to be some of the most superb in the world, with the highest population densities of wildlife anywhere. And yet suddenly, in the course of 10, 15, 20 years, the land is being privatized, it's being subdivided up into small acreages. And because people are now sedentary on a very small site, they're degrading the land, and you can see it happening before your very eyes.
The Indian has never considered land a commodity. That's not in his experience, not in his traditions. So when he encounters the idea that land can be owned and that it ought to be used for the immediate good of the state, this is a false idea. It's one that is alien to him. But we grow up in a society now, in modern America, where we have the idea that land is to be used, and we are obligated in some way to take what is under the ground and use it for our immediate good. And we lose sight of the fact that there are people coming after us.
The land ethic is an earth ethic. It's just that it was really articulated about the landscape that Aldo Leopold mostly knew and mostly worked in, and was the reality for most of the people around him. But you can't have land without sea. There wouldn't be any life on Earth, so you need a land ethic and a sea ethic. It's all the same thing. And then you need an air ethic, because we've learned in the last few decades that we're also really changing the atmosphere. So what is land, sea, and air? It's the earth, but it really is, it's the life ethic, is really what it is. It's the life ethic.
Leopold's thinking is universal. Leopold's thinking, although it grows out of an attachment to a place, its pertinence goes beyond the place itself. And the fact that his thinking, in a way, evolved out of his universal experiences in Mexico, in Germany, in the Southwest, in the Midwest, then it becomes relevant to all the world. Thank you.